Now, LinkedIn has been around several years. Let me show you some slightly off-topic things, then we'll get back into it. LinkedIn is a publicly traded company, meaning you can buy shares in LinkedIn stock in the stock market. So if you buy shares in LinkedIn and LinkedIn does well, you do well. And so here I'm seeing that over the past month, LinkedIn shares have done well. It's about $192 a share for LinkedIn, which is actually higher than Facebook. Facebook shares are at about 105 or something. That's what it did a month. However, it hasn't had a very good year. There was a huge crash in LinkedIn stock that brought it down for a long while there. And if I look at it in the in all time, it's been up and down and volatile, a huge crash, and it hasn't quite recovered, but LinkedIn is still valuable. So valuable that actually Microsoft bought them for $26 billion within the last month or two. So big old Microsoft felt that LinkedIn was valuable enough to buy it for $26 billion. Before LinkedIn was in, when it was independent, I just to for curiosity, LinkedIn bought SlideShare back in 2012 for $118 million. And then a little later in 2015, LinkedIn bought Lynda.com for $1.5 billion. And then Microsoft bought LinkedIn and everything that it had for $26 billion last month or 2 months ago. And that has helped its stock. Notice it's recovered from some of that right there. So just a little off topic there, LinkedIn as a company, but for us as a tool. Let me get back to LinkedIn here. Wherever you're at, if you go back to the home screen, so either click the LinkedIn icon or click the home button. This is the screen where you share content, you share updates. And a lot of what we talked about on the other network still applies, but we'll look at the nuances. Here, I've got my account under Home, and I have Share and Update, Upload a Photo. If I click Share and Update, it gives me a spot to write something, which I can still attach a photo to. I can choose to share this public just with my connection. So if I've already connected with 10 people on LinkedIn, only they will see it. And I've also got Share Publicly and to Twitter. So if I select that, this would then say, OK, connect your Twitter. So that if I post something to LinkedIn, it'll automatically go over to my Twitter. That'll help me cut down on so many things I need to manage. Last month we talked about creating and using a Twitter account, and here we've got LinkedIn. Well, if you post something on LinkedIn, it can automatically get sent out to Twitter. Twitter, remember, is 140 characters. Here we can write a lot more. So LinkedIn will cut it a little bit and add a link back to the full article that you wrote here on LinkedIn. So here's how I can save some effort with those two networks. I don't see Share to Facebook. There used to be one years ago. But now, because Facebook is so big, it's the 800-pound gorilla, it makes the rules, it no longer allows that sort of sharing from this network. So I would still have to manually share the same thing here on LinkedIn and go and open my Facebook and share it to Facebook. I can do upload photo and it'll upload a photo. So what would I share here? Again, think in terms about what we talked about last month, but I'll reiterate it here. What to share on LinkedIn? We have company updates, such as success stories, testimonials. We can share free content such as a free PDF, a free blog or article. Links to my main website. So to the home page, to a blog post. on my website to a landing page. I mentioned landing pages before. Anyone remember what's a landing page? A secret page that users can only get to via a special link. I need to go to my website. I create a page on my website, and the only way to get to that page is via a specific link. You cannot get to that page from the menu of my website. There's no links anywhere on my main website to get to that page. It's quote-unquote secret, but not so secret that no one knows about it, of course. Secret in that I send out an email to all of my distribution list with that link, and only my email followers get it. I have Twitter, and I use that link, and I only share that link on Twitter. So if you're following me on Twitter, you're in the VIP circle. If I'm on LinkedIn, again, I create a special landing page on my site and only share that on my LinkedIn. Well, you should be seeing then, that's part of the reason why I want to build audiences on the various networks. If someone's already on Facebook, how am I going to entice them to follow me on LinkedIn? If they're already on Twitter, why would I get them over to Instagram? That's unique content per network. Even though it's easy for me to share one thing to all my networks, then there's not much of an incentive for everyone to follow me on the different networks. Obviously, that's a lot more work. But if I only share certain things on LinkedIn, that's an enticement for people to follow me on LinkedIn. If I only share certain things on Facebook, that's an enticement for people to follow me on Facebook. It's obviously double the work, triple the work, quadruple the work, but it could result in you getting more followers, more valuable followers on each of the networks if you share content that is specific to each network. Company updates, free content, links to your own website, inspirational or aka non-selling posts. A lot of the time I'm going to be posting a sales pitch, and that might not be the best word for it, but it's the most accurate. It's the word that I'm trying to sell something. I'm trying to promote something of mine. I'm trying to convince people, click here, look at this, read that. I'm selling them something, literally or figuratively. Let's say I have a website where I give completely, for the kindness of my heart, I give financial advice. I want people to visit my site to get my financial advice. I'm not really going to sell them anything, but I want to give that advice. I'm still doing a sales pitch. Come visit my website. So these over here are going to be sort of like sales pitch type of posts, like I would do on Twitter, like I would do on Google+, whatever. Once in a while, I'm not going to do those selling posts. I'm not always going to be selling. I'm not always going to be hitting people over the head with sale, 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 buy, buy. We can do the 80-20 ratio. 80% sales pitch posts, 20% non-sales pitch posts. A simple photo of a sunset to inspire. A picture of something interesting and meaningful to you. A quote that is inspirational. Nothing to sell, just to build community. Because 100% sales pitches are going to have people perhaps enticed to click unfollow. Too many sales pitches. I'm getting hit over the head every time with something new for sale. You can vary this up, of course. 50-50, sure. 90-10, sure. But I'm saying, don't always do a sales pitch. Once in a while, something non-sales. And then I can also do 80-20 via 80% original content, 20% repurposed content. So most of the time, I'm going to try to create my own photo, shoot my own photo, write my own article, make my own links. That's what I'm going to be sharing most of the time. Once in a while, I'm going to share other things. I'm going to share Shay's post. I want other people to see that. I'm going to go share someone else's article from their website, from their LinkedIn, from their Twitter. I'm going to share someone else's. The purpose of me sharing my own stuff, of course, is because I want my stuff to be found by more people. I want my stuff to be shared furthermore. I want my stuff to reach more eyeballs. Why would I share other people's stuff? That's the whole point of what we talked about regarding previously about building more followers and such. When I create a Twitter account brand new, no one knows I exist. If I start to interact with other people, if I start to share other people's stuff, they get a notification up on the top here. Victor's Bakery shared your post. That other company then gets a notification. Victor's Bakery exists. Let me perhaps follow them. Let me perhaps reply to them. Let me perhaps buy something of theirs. Same thing on LinkedIn. Carrie Sommer here is sharing, Lemonade Stand can teach you this about PR. Okay, it sounds interesting. 577 people have liked 22 comments. It doesn't share, it doesn't say how many shares, but other people have liked this enough that they shared it to more people. Carrie got all these notifications on top here about likes and replies and all of that. And then it's up to Carrie to decide, let me check out who is Shay Lumberg. Let me check out who's Mach Fitrianto. Let me check out who they are. And if they're valuable, if they have a properly filled in profile and a picture, president and CEO of Arrowpoint Insurance, hey, I need insurance. Maybe let me get in contact with them. Let me see their profile, maybe. So the point of you sharing other people's work is to make yourself make yourself known to other people that can possibly connect with you. Share other people's content to make them aware of you. They may then view your profile, share, comment, like your content. In the Holy Grail, they may connect with you. Actually, the Holy Grail, you may get a sale, whatever you're trying to do online. That's obviously the biggest goal of all. How can I turn my followers into sales? That's always the biggest goal, the hardest one. But in between all of, to get to the highest level, you have these levels which are still valuable. Those likes and those comments are valuable. It shows that these people are real people, not spammers. Let me connect with that person that gave a real, useful reply. Vice versa, they see your stuff. You're gonna post a few things, and then you're going to try to connect with other people, and they will decide. They filled in their profile, they have a biography, they have valuable experience, maybe I'll click to connect. Nothing ventured, nothing gained. That's why you're gonna fill in your full profile, your icon, and all of that. And once in a while, you will be sharing other people's content to make them aware that you exist, for you to get possibly connections, sales, calls, whatever. So again, what to post here is, I can't quite teach that, but here's an example. Let's say I have a link I want to share. Share an update. It doesn't exactly say share a link, but you still can. If you have a link, either memorized or cut and paste, here's one that I have memorized, vmcink.net/pouchdb-intro. That is an article. Let's see if I spell it right. That's an article that I wrote about this computer topic. Databases. I have the link of some particular item on my website. It could. Yeah, you just need to get its link, so you look up on your Google Doc and whatever its link is up there, you copy that and you paste it here.
So I have some link, I'm adding it here, and it creates a little preview based on the graphic found on the link. It takes a little bit of a blurb about what was written on the link, which you can edit. If you click, you'll be able to edit all of that.
And so here I'm sharing some link. I'm also possibly going to write a little bit about it, but I can share links on LinkedIn. I can give people a little blurb, a little taste of what they're going to read if they click through. It's still up to you to create compelling content. So let's say here, obviously this is off topic of what this business is, Victor's Bakery, John's Bakery, whatever. But let's say if I was a tech person and I wanted to get hired, I could write something like the latest article on how to use a database in your project. Do you have a database? Notice as I'm typing, it may be suggesting, do you mean these people? You can also mention people, not necessarily a connection that you have, but you can mention people on LinkedIn. That's giving them the notification. The purpose of that is giving them the notification that I exist. Do you have a database that you prefer? Questions are always good. But let's say this is inspired by, and just choosing a random person. I don't know any of these people. Let's say I use select Datar. Datar will get a notification that says, Victor Campos mentioned you on LinkedIn. Obviously, this can be abused. Datar does not know me. They might click block. They may ignore. They may click the button that I'm harassing them. This, be careful about this. This will let you mention anyone on LinkedIn, even if you're not connected with them. It's a very specific purpose why you would do this. You would do this to help get your message viewed by more people. Let's make a note here. This works on Twitter very well. On LinkedIn, you have to be careful, which is mentioning people in your posts can have the value of letting them know, so notifying them that you exist. They may then amplify your message. That's the fancy term of saying they may then share your post to more people. I have 7 connections, and I shared it to Datar, and Datar has 100 connections, and Datar chooses to share it. I've reached 107 people, the 7 that I had originally, and now the connections of a connection, 107, potentially. They may then amplify your message, share to more people. I just did this personally on Twitter a couple of days ago. That article there that I wrote about that database, I wrote that. I then went on Twitter, I tweeted about it, and within the tweet I mentioned 2 of the people that work on that project. One of them said, thanks for that great article. They shared it to their 1,000 followers, and now they shared it to someone else, someone else, someone else, and now that article has reached many more people than the only 730 people that I have. I reached probably like 10,000 people. In my case, it was simply to share some knowledge. But if that was a post with a sale link on it, a buy now link or some other sort of sales pitch, I could have potentially reached 10,000 people. 1% of 10,000, again, I'm not going to sell 10,000 things. I'm going to sell perhaps 1% of 10,000. For me, it was just get this message out to more people. Actually, the purpose also was, if they go read my article, there's a Google ad there. If people click on the Google ad, I get a little revenue from the Google ads. And I've made like a cool 46 cents so far on that article. So if you are much more into blogging and do it much more regularly, you could make money off your website, off your blogs, affiliate links, and all of that. But you might not be able to go that far on your own, so that's the purpose. That's the point of mentioning other people on Twitter, on Facebook, on pretty much every other network. But of course the downside is we have no connection. We don't know each other here. I don't know how this person is gonna take me mentioning them here. And I choose to share that, it gets published, everyone that follows me would see it, therefore no one sees it right now, I have no followers. I can go back to what I wrote, and if I click on the little where the timestamp is at, if I hover over the corner, I've got delete, copy link to share, report this update. So if I want to remove it, I can do that. This will tell me who has liked it and shared it and all of that. That doesn't make sense for my own, but for someone else. If it was like an offensive article, I can report it to the community so that, you know, it's nicer. Okay. For my own, it doesn't make sense to report myself. Unless you're very honest. I can copy a link to share. This particular post has its own unique link on LinkedIn. I can copy that and share it over on Twitter. I can put it on my mailing list. I can put it elsewhere. Each individual thing I share can then further be on LinkedIn, can further be shared elsewhere. Mine doesn't have this. Mine doesn't have the third type of sharing. Yours might, and you will get this other type of sharing once you verify your email. Right now it's just a fake test email, so I don't have this extra feature. I have not verified. I have not said I'm a real person. But eventually when you do, you will have the option to post a blog. Right now, sharing an update is really just about some quick text and a link, or maybe a picture. But once you verify, you'll have blog post. And there, I can't show it to you because it's not verified, but there is where I will be able to craft a 500-word article if I want, with bullet points and links and some formatting and graphics and pictures like a real article. And so I can set up a whole blog system on LinkedIn. I don't have to go to any ancillary other website to do that. I can have it all consolidated in this account. The blog post, of course, will have its own link. And if I have the time and the idea, I could write a more complete, full-fledged post here on LinkedIn and share it with people. If your account is verified, check your inbox for the verification link. You get extra features like the blog post feature. Write long form articles or formatting, pictures, links, length, etc. That would be the inbox of your email account. So if I have, you know, victor@gmail.com, I would go to my Gmail to check that. And if you don't have one, if it's been a while since you verified, at the top it'll say send another confirmation link. And then I check my inbox on Gmail and then confirm it. So when we were talking about the other networks, I had given some advice. Before trying to forge connections, before trying to get followers, you should be first sharing some content. I have no followers, but still, share content before trying to build a network. The reason is, why would anyone connect with you? if you have nothing to offer them. No picture, no bio, no resume, no posts. What's in it for them to connect with you? They don't know anything about you. You're just a generic person icon, like a spammer. You have nothing filled in for your education or business experience, like a spammer. You don't have any posts that are valuable for people to want to read. The reason someone connects with you is because they want to see your content. You don't have content. Why would they follow you? Why would they connect with you like every other network? And it applies pretty much the same thing as well here. Did anyone remember, like, how many is a good starting point of content to share early on?
3 to 5
posts on a variety of related topics to start off with. Yes, I have no followers. Yes, I'm going to be talking to no one. But once we start to look at the things we'll see in a moment about actually building connections and such, then we'll have something to show for it. When someone says, "What's Victor Campos about?" Oh, I click on their profile and I see these great articles, this free stuff, these links. I'll click follow. If I don't have anything to show for it, less of an enticement for people to follow. I'm saying a variety of related topics. This is, again, 80%, 20%. Maybe beginning this stuff, if I'm going to do three of them, all three of them don't have to be a sales pitch. Two of them could be inspirational. One of them's a sales pitch. If right away, if someone looks at your content and your account is pretty new, and all your content right now is pretty much sales pitches, 80% of sales pitches, less of an enticement for someone to follow you. So maybe your first posts, before trying to build connections, should all be the non-sales pitch posts, so you don't scare people away. After you've got the connections, some connections, then you start to be a little bit more about sales pitches. Okay, so what to share a little bit more specifically? Let me answer that question this way. Actually, you'll need to remind me from last month if you were here. Did we ever see the website socialmediaexaminer.com? If you were here last month, anyone remember socialmediaexaminer.com? No? Okay, good. So let's check out this website. Take a little detour here. Socialmediaexaminer.com. This is one of many websites, trade journals, on a topic. The topic here is all about social media. This website has lots and lots of articles about social media. Newest features of networks, newest social networks, advice on topics to post, tips specifically on LinkedIn. It's telling me right away, get your free copy of the 2016 Social Media Marketing Industry Report. It's totally free, I just want the report. It's going to ask you for your email. This tactic right here that it's showing is a good tactic. It's out of our scope. But notice, I went to the website, someone's recommending me the website. The first thing that pops up is, you know, wondering how your peers are using social media, discover how social media works, check out our 56-page article, our 56-page book, 90 charts. I want the report, it'll ask you for your email. This is one of the tried and true tactics of marketing on a website. What can you give people away? What can you give people? It is free. however, in exchange for their email. In exchange for their email, you're building an email distribution list. If you've got on your website something that simply says, subscribe to the newsletter, or subscribe to us, there's very little incentive for people to do that. Why am I going to give my email address again? Is my email going to get resold to someone else and I'm going to get spam? So the simple subscribe now might not be as effective. However, quid pro quo, if I give you our 56-page industry report and you give us your email, perhaps a fair trade. The person can decide to unsubscribe later. And this, of course, is out of our scope. I can't tell you how to do this. You have to check your website software. Can I do this? How do I do this? Check your web designer. Is there a way to get some kind of pop-up like this? This, of course, assumes there's something for you to give away. A 56-page book is kind of a lot of work for me to do, but what about a 5-page PDF that I make in Word in exchange for someone's email address, building a list of contacts? I'll say no thanks, but it'll keep mentioning it. It's the Social Media Examiner, your guide to the social media jungle. They have all of these great articles on all of these things. How to measure social media using Google Analytics. 3 tips for pinning video on Pinterest. How to use Snapchat memories to improve your marketing. 8 ways to use Pokemon Go for business. So on and on. There's a new article every day, a couple new articles every day. What's going to happen is it's going to pop up and tell you why not subscribe. And they actually have a conference, the Social Media Success Summit, which is not free. And it says here, save $400. That's pretty pricey. But that's the main purpose of this website. A lot of great free articles. Articles are great, but I need more hands-on. Well, here's our conference. See if you can find a real price on it. Look at all these great names in the world of social media that you can learn about, learn with. Let's see, what's our price? $697 for a ticket. Limited time only, $297. Anyway, you don't need any of the paid stuff, of course, but socialmediaexaminer.com is going to be full of a lot of great updates in the world of social media. And if you find on the right side, browse categories or search, you can hone in on what are your articles about LinkedIn. Let's see, do we have a category on LinkedIn? How to podcast reviews. I can search. If you search LinkedIn, list of social media, Life Social, LinkedIn. LinkedIn groups, tell me about LinkedIn groups, social media, the share button, strategy, LinkedIn strategy, recommendations. I'm just going to search basic LinkedIn. How to create more exposure using LinkedIn, how to build a LinkedIn marketing plan, how to maximize your content exposure, how to transform your LinkedIn profile into a marketing tool, 5 LinkedIn marketing tips. I'll look at the latest one, which is March of this year. You see, there's an article from an expert, Alexandra, and there's text, there's pictures, there's tangible things. This is a blog post. This is an article. Someone wrote this in service for, most likely, getting more people to buy a ticket to that conference. On my own website, John's Bakery, I want people to buy cupcakes. I want people to buy cookies. I want people to come to my store and buy my products. But I'm going to write articles to help me get found, to entice people to check out my website. And as they see free content, they may then click buy now, book a table, map to the store. So if you take the blogging class on Friday, we go into detail. We do brainstorming. We do strategies on blogging, because this is also part of the modern way of SEO, search engine optimization. SEO, search engine optimization. The art and the science and the magic of getting more traffic to your online presence. Your website, your eBay listing, your Etsy shop, whatever, your Craigslist ad. I need people to see it. SEO. What do I do to optimize my website so that the search engines find me, so that people find me? That's the Monday class. There's still space there if you're interested. Come next Monday. Part of SEO, part of modern SEO, because these SEO concepts change every few months or years. Part of modern SEO use social media. Reach an audience via social media, like LinkedIn, like Instagram, like Twitter. Part of modern SEO is write blogs. Use social media to find a captive audience. Most likely, actually, find an interested audience that becomes a captive audience. Your followers are a captive audience. A follower has chosen to connect to your account to see what you're about. They're a captive audience. You find an audience in social media to market to advertise. That billboard on the 5 there, people are seeing it all day long. 1% of those people perhaps actually call that phone number to hire that plumber. Well, if that plumber could show that billboard directly to more people, not just whoever drives by on the 5, they could get more sales. That's what social media is. I can show that billboard to more people directly that would care about it in social media. Writing blogs is important for modern SEO to create content with keywords that people search for. Let's say I'm a plumber. I'm that same plumber. I want people to hire me as a plumber. Someone goes on a search engine and types in, they're not going to type simply plumber. They're going to type something like plumber and a zip code, or affordable plumber and Imperial Beach. If I have those keywords on my website, that could help me get found. Maybe someone is trying to do their own fixing. Why does my faucet leak? Someone could literally type that into a Google search, a Yahoo search. Why does my faucet leak? And I have an article on my website that is called that. Why does my faucet leak? I'm giving away free advice on my website about plumbing. Some people will read that article, fix their thing, and never call me. Some people will try to fix it, make it worse, and call me. Some people will say, this seems complicated, let me call them. So if I'm writing blogs, they're full of keywords of what people could search for, and they could find me and hire me. In the Friday blogging class, we brainstorm. This website wants to sell you a $600 ticket to their social media conference. They're going to show you, look at all these great things that you can learn. LinkedIn, Facebook, this and that. It sounds really cool and useful, but I don't have time to do it. Let me maybe hire someone. They can provide also those services. So here, this one is mentioning about a company page, which we'll look at in a moment. It's mentioning SlideShare, which we talked about. Publish on Publisher. That's their blog platform. I suppose it's officially called Publisher. It's saying use the blog post feature on LinkedIn. I did not read this article before today, so it's not that I'm copying them. But we're seeing here, things that I'm talking about are listed here. This is the one about the paid things. Promote with sponsored updates. like on Facebook, where we could do boosted posts to reach more people if we pay for it. We can reach more people on LinkedIn by paying for it. Sponsored updates. Yes, regarding paid content, some amount of people will see an ad on Twitter, on Facebook, on LinkedIn, and ignore it. Some people will actively ignore it. Some people will passively ignore it. But some amount of people will see an ad that really resonates with them of a product or something and click. So if you spent, let's say, $100 on a promotion on LinkedIn and it made you a sale of $500, it was probably worth it. If you spent $100 and it made you a sale of $20, is it worth it monetarily? Maybe not, but you might have built a relationship with a new customer that in the future could result in more sales. So all of the explanation of why groups, again, I've mentioned groups, we'll look at groups. So then we've got people's comments. I think comments are valuable on this site. I think serious people comment on these sites, on this site. Comments can easily go out of control and people write spam and off-topic things and all of that. But I think here they moderate their comments and they let the good ones go through. I like to look at the comments on Social Media Examiner because people here are serious and someone may be sharing something that I didn't know about or that is not listed in the article where I can get more knowledge. The original author seems to be replying to people. Someone is having a specific issue, the author replied to that. Again, this website's pretty serious about what they post. See right there. Alex is replying to what people have written as follows up. Notice what she's saying. I recommend, okay, this is saying, this is great for business, what about personal? And she's saying, first and foremost, I would recommend filling out your profile completely and creating a unique address. Isn't that what I just said earlier today? Again, I did not read this article before today. But Social Media Examiner is one of the sites that I like here to keep up to date with social media. We'll list one more, then we'll get back to LinkedIn. If you go over to... Let me write it here in the notes. Recommended sites to keep up to date with social media. SocialMediaExaminer.com. And Mashable.com, M-A-S-H-A-B-L-E, Mashable.com. Social Media Examiner is a in-depth focus on all social media. Mashable is more general technology, general tech and social articles. Look at that briefly. Mashable.com. Let's check it out. If on the top left corner, let's see, your screen might look a little different from mine. On the top left corner, mine has a little menu that opens up if yours doesn't, but I've got a little menu up there. And then there's a section, social media. If I focus on the social media articles, here's an article on Snapchat. Three simple ways to avoid making big mistakes as a teen using social media. we're probably not teens in here, but I would still read that. People make these mistakes even if you're not a teen, so I would read that. So this is the section on social media. You can also, it's got a search at the top right corner of the little magnifying glass. You can search specifically then what are LinkedIn articles. So those are a couple of websites to keep up to date with this stuff of social media and technology. Does anyone have an opinion? Sites that you may visit regarding these topics? We'll mention a few more as time goes on, but those are some good ones. Let's get back to final questions, and then we'll get back to LinkedIn. Any questions about Social Media Examiner or Mashable? Okay, back to LinkedIn. We've been looking here that this is the personal aspect of your site. You want to go in to edit your profile if it makes sense for you and fill in as many of these things as make sense. Experience is your work experience. Notice you can add more of your work experience under position. You can attach documents. This is relatively new. You can say, I worked at this business, let me show pictures regarding that. Let me show video or presentation. Let me attach these things to show my experience in a company. Like a resume, it'll be in reverse chronological order. The newest job will be at the top. So if I were to add a new position, if the company exists on LinkedIn, I would fill it in here. We haven't created our company, so perhaps we might wait on this. But let's say I work at, you know, Qualcomm. Qualcomm will be listed here. And what was my title there? I choose a title based on what exists, location, time period description. Whenever there's anything that you need to fill in and there's examples, look at those examples because LinkedIn itself is telling you what works in LinkedIn. So I'm about to fill in something about my experience in Qualcomm. And I'm going to write something like, wrote code. Well, if I see the example, position described should provide some details of the position so users viewing your profile can get a quick idea. Some examples: brand development, website traffic growth, website UI and advertising revenue. Generated new development deals for a real estate development company that focuses on multifamily, blah blah blah. It sounds like a classic resume. Active language, being specific what you did. It's a resume 2.0. Of course, you can skip all of this if you're not going to use LinkedIn as the person. But if you are going to be, if your face is going to be part of the face of the company, this is all really important stuff to fill in. Is it important for your education? Perhaps view more. A summary, skills, languages, volunteering experience. Look at all of these things you could fill in to help you get found. Because in search, someone is looking for an organization. You put that organization in your resume here. They could find you. Do you have patents? Do you have causes you care about? Are you involved in projects? Have you made publications? Do you have certifications? Interest, personal advice for contacting? How will you let people find you? Anything that I publish here, by default then, my network, my followers will see. If I don't want my followers to see, I just added new education, I can turn that off. We're not going to spend too much time on this. You need to look at this to see if it's important to you, but here are a variety of places that you can fill in content, and it'll tell you.
People with a photo get 11 times more views. Members with high school on their profile get 7 times more views. If you have skills, you are 4 times more likely to get found.
Because there's so much data nowadays. All of these networks have so much data that this search is so invaluable. We will use it in a moment to help us build connections. But filling this stuff in could help you get found, could get connections. And again, approve of connections that are valuable to you. Any questions on this before moving on? Filling in more details of your profile? Let's say we go over to interests and we go back to companies. If it says leave page, I'm going to leave page. This is the part about, okay, I've got a personal account and I've got the business page like I showed earlier. So under create a company page, I can click create. Company page offers public information about each company on LinkedIn. So only current employees are eligible to create a company page. It's my company, I'm an employee, so that counts. And so here, if I'm creating the company, John's Amazing Bakery, email address, before I fill that in, I verify that I'm an official representative of this company and have the right to act on behalf of my company. Probably yes, it's your company. But here's a stumbling block. Your email address at the company. If I'm trying to do johnsbakery@gmail.com, it won't like it. If I'm trying to do, sorry, Gmail is not valid. Of course it's valid. It's a website that exists. It's not a valid company domain. For further questions, check customer service. What this is saying, it's expecting something like this, john@johnsbakery.com. Not Gmail, not Yahoo Mail, not free mail, not spam mail. Any person can create a Gmail, any person can create a Yahoo account, AOL account, whatever. Therefore, any spammer can.
This is expecting you to have an email address at your website.
This is expecting you have a website. There's no way around this, really. So, this is out of our scope, but for you to create this, and this can be anything, you know, sales at John's Bakery, this could be info, at, you know, victor.org. I need some real domain website address with some email address attached to it. I need to go over to my service provider, whatever I may have, GoDaddy, Bluehost, HostMonster, etc., and see how do I create a company email address there, because Hotmail's not going to cut it. Gmail's not going to cut it. None of those. You're going to need a real address at a company to create your company profile here. I'm creating a company page. You need a company email. Gmail, Yahoo Mail, etc. will not work. So check with your provider, also known as domain registrar, on how to create one. We'll say here, no, victorsbakery@gmail.com, yes, victor@victorsbakery.com. Let's see if this will fall for it for the moment. victorsbakery.com. We're sorry that a new company cannot be created at this time. For further questions, contact our customer. Have other people today tried to create one at the moment? Sometimes what happens is that if multiple people from one location are trying to do this, LinkedIn gets confused. Why are different people trying to create this account here? So it might not let you. So I would try this at home if you're trying to create the company page. So
it's not going to let me proceed very far. You're going to need to try it at home. But the concept here is that LinkedIn gives us this ability to create these company pages. It's just that it's a little protective when we try to do it in this public room. There's several people at once, so LinkedIn gets confused. Again, you have to decide, will you use LinkedIn? You're welcome. Will you use LinkedIn as you, as the person, or as the business? I want to use it as the business. We saw that article in Social Media Examiner that says, use your company page. I can't proceed here, but we can easily see that once I fill this in, I will get a screen where I can manage my page and I can post updates, just like personal. What I would do is, I would log in and I would go to my company's interests and companies. And here it's going to say, manage your page. It's going to list all my pages, my company pages, and I click manage. Once I manage, then I'm going to share a link, a picture, an article. I'm going to do 80% sales pitches, 20% inspirational things. So it's basically using it as personal, but it's just not your face. It's not your resume and college experience. It's what you're sharing as part of the company. We can set more managers, like over on Facebook and such, other people to help us manage that same page, because I'm going to run out of things to say, but perhaps other people in the company can help. I can't show it because it won't let me, but there will be a screen there to let me let more people help me post to my page. So to see what other companies have done, let's say I'm this bakery, I'm going to search companies regarding baking or bakeries. These companies may appear, and what I could do is I could go to a particular company and see, well, what are they sharing? It's all in Russian. But I can see what are others sharing to give me ideas. We mentioned that concept on the other classes, on the other networks. Search to see what other people are sharing. Let's give this a try. On the top search box, you can hone your criteria or leave it as is. Let's say you're going to search for a keyword about your company, what your company does and such. At the top, let's say cooking. I'm going to skip any suggestions, and I'm going to search a keyword. I can still refine it here on the side. People, groups, jobs and such, groups. Casual cooking group, hospitality and food service network. So different groups that are appearing on a particular topic. As I said, anyone can create a group because someone created the Cooking with Herbs and Spices group, and 19 members are there. Whereas the Cooking Italian Recipes has 6,000 members. So again, I would recommend getting into an existing group rather than making your own. And they're multilingual. I can go look at the Dutch cooking group. And if I know Dutch? They speak Dutch? Dutch, yeah, language Dutch. If I know Dutch, I can go look at those. Casual cooking, if I click on a group, it'll say what this group is about. And this is related to when we talked about Google Plus.
as I said, Google Plus, I like it. It's powerful if you focus what you post into communities. People that care about a topic on Google Plus congregate in a community. Therefore, I'm going to post content to a community. LinkedIn has the same thing. I need to find communities, groups, based on keywords and topics of what my business is. And it's nice that I'm going to share stuff on my main profile. No one's going to see it. I have no followers. But if instead I share and comment and am active in a community, in a group, about a topic, that'll be more effective. I'm reaching, right here I have no connections, and potentially I'm going to reach 13,500 right off the bat. Some groups are very easy to join. This one says ask to join. What did we say about ask to join on Google Plus? Someone has to check you out. Someone has to vet you. Someone has to see what are they posting, what are they about, have they filled in their profile. Let's now allow them to join our exclusive community. Some communities on Google Plus, you just click join and you're in. Same thing on LinkedIn. This one says you've got to ask. We've got to check you out. Are you worthy to be user number 13,598? Well, if I am, I'm going to get in and reach all those people. American Society of Baking, 5,000 members. Cake Bakers and Decorators, 6,000 bakers. See, this one's simply join. Those that I cannot join right away will say view it first. But if I click a group, here's the administrators, 5,000 members. About this group, I don't really see content yet. Oh, it does still say ask to join. So they're going to check me out to see if I'm worthy, and then I could be a new member, and then I'll have the ability now when I'm over on my interests groups. What people have shared on the group will be listed here. Groups that I have joined will be listed here, pending, and so forth. So this is a way to ramp up your connections on LinkedIn. You go to, this is how you reach an audience that cares about what your company is. You look for groups and you connect to them, you share them, you can connect to as many as you want. Do so. If they make sense, join 10 groups. Use them to your advantage, but follow the rules. Read the rules of the group. They'll be listed somewhere on the side there. It might tell you, please only share one thing per week. Maybe I didn't read that and I shared something every day this week. Best case scenario, the administrator tells you, hey, be careful, you're breaking the rules. Worst case scenario, they kick you out of the group and you lost access to 5,000 people. Just like Google Plus. If I don't follow the rules, I lose access to all those people. And it happens. And you may have recourse or not. Basically, LinkedIn is pretty hands-off. As long as it's following the general rules of LinkedIn, LinkedIn is not going to intercede and get you back into a group because you got kicked out because you broke the rules or because the moderators are jerks. As long as everyone's following the basic rules, decisions will stand. So the way really you're going to use LinkedIn then is setting up a fully fleshed out personal profile or creating a company and using groups. SlideShare then is another way to reach an audience. And getting ideas of the content to share, to post, can come from these sites. And so the class in general is an overview of a particular network. We're seeing similarities over and over. Some of the things I talked about sharing and the 80-20 rule and all of that, we heard about it in other networks. A lot of these things overlap. But then some networks have specific things, like we saw here. So whatever we learn from one network, we can apply to some degree to other ones. We're seeing that it's a lot of work. So I'll show you this website, and then we're winding down for the day. I'm going to shift gears a little bit out of LinkedIn. Any questions on LinkedIn as we come to the end of the day?
So you're starting to talk about slide share and the groups. Does that mesh, or is that something?
It is a little bit different because on groups, you would go to the group, share to the group of like-minded people. SlideShare needs its own sort of, to some degree, its own day to talk about, which we don't quite have time for. But SlideShare is where we would go to create these presentations and share at SlideShare, which then other people comment and reply to and share themselves. It's just another angle to share to more people, to reach more people.
So I suppose if you went to the group, after you made a SlideShare,
yes, every item that's over on SlideShare has its own unique link. And I can share that link once I'm in a community. You know, I could click post to the group, write a little blurb, post a link, and if someone is interested, they can further click that to go see the presentation. So synergy right there. I have something on SlideShare, sharing it to a group. Traffic back and forth. Yes, exactly. Anything that I can create on any network, basically I can share to any network. They all have a unique link. So when we talk about YouTube, we have something, we have, let's say, a 5-minute presentation I did on YouTube. That has its own link. I can get that link, copy and paste it into a LinkedIn group, and have more people see it. That's why that all comes back down to this about SEO. Modern SEO is about social media. I wrote that article about that database. I wanted people to see it. I got on Twitter. I reached out to the right people. They helped me spread the message to reach more people, and I can look at my stats, and I'm seeing stats here, and then a jump because I got a lot of traffic for it from social media, from the marketing. This is marketing in the new generation, advertising. To keep up to date with all of this is a big endeavor we're seeing. I've got to create a profile here and here and here and share to each one. LinkedIn is making it a little bit easier in that what I can share here, I can send it off over to Twitter by activating that. But there are several other websites out there that help you automatically share to more networks. Here's one. Let's check out this website, buffer.com. Buffer is a way for you to easily share to more than one network at once. Instead of me going to every single network, even if I'm sharing the same thing, it's still a lot of work. Logging in, copying and pasting, publish 5 times for all my networks. At Buffer, I can go to Buffer, connect my Pinterest, my Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, Google Plus, LinkedIn, connect all my networks to my one Buffer account for free. Log into Buffer, craft my message, and Buffer will send it to all my networks. I can schedule it also with Buffer. Say something's going to be shared this Monday, something next Tuesday, something into Fridays from now. There is the free version and the paid version. Let's check pricing. Let's see what the pricing looks like at the moment. The individual free plan gives you one per platform, so I'll be able to share to all the big ones. 10 posts scheduled per profile. If I get the awesome plan, I think that's $10 a month, I can have 10 10 Twitters, 10 Instagrams, only one at a time on the free one. If I'm in part of a business or a team, that's $99 a year or something, 25, 5 members, so more than up to 5 different people sharing to these networks, 2,000 things at a time. If you're up to $400, you can have 150 LinkedIn accounts that you're connected to. 25 people managing it all, with 2,000 posts. Obviously, for us, this is really out of our range. But for McDonald's, this is perfect. It's a deal. For Nike, this is what they need. And even on the most basic one, notice you get a lot of features. You don't get a calendar, but not that important. The analytics, the data to check is this working, doesn't start until the larger packages. But in the networks themselves, I can see also I got 7 replies, I got 2 shares. Buffer would aggregate it all into a nice screen, but that's starting at the $99 level. There's a business one which usually is more expensive, but you might not need that one. This is $10 a month. So the completely free one works really well, and it shows it's free forever. And that could be a way for you to manage everything.
For business, how do you feel about 10 posts per month versus more? Is 10 posts enough?
Probably not. You probably want to post a little bit more than that, but as a beginner, that's perfectly fine. As you use these networks more, you're going to see, well, maybe I should post a little bit more to reach more of an audience. But that free starting point is definitely very good, a very good starting point. Buffer.com used to share to multiple accounts at once. Pros, cons. Basic features are free. Share to all networks quickly. Schedule posts. I've got a business to run, and I've got to be changed to Twitter, to LinkedIn. Well, you can schedule posts. Cons. Better features are not free. Homogeneous. Is that how you spell it? Homogeneous? Homogeneous content. Everything's the same. You're sharing the same thing to all the networks. It is a little more effective to share different things to different networks. Like I said previously, why would I follow you on Twitter if I'm already following you on Facebook?
But if you're trying to get one message across.
Yeah. That's perfectly fine, exactly. If it's the same message to everyone, this is perfectly fine.
If you use Buffer to do the 10 posts, do you go to Buffer to create the post?
Mm-hmm.
Then you can do the 10 posts that are homogeneous,
mm-hmm.
and then you could go to each individual
network
and do another post, right?
Yes.
Okay.
Exactly. So 10 things that are homogeneous and scheduled, and then individually as many as you want per network, crafted for each network. Homogeneous content and not quite optimized per platform. I'm going to write on my Buffer a paragraph, which is going to look quite nice on LinkedIn and Facebook. But that paragraph is going to be shrunk down to on Twitter. And that paragraph might not show up or look very well on Instagram because it's picture-based. So it's not quite then optimized for every single platform as it could be. But again, you are free to use this as one of the tools to manage all of this. And you log in individually to each platform. Each platform now, so a few years ago, I wished I could schedule my tweets. You can schedule your tweets now in Twitter, but this all aggregates it together. You can schedule your tweets on your posts on Facebook as well, but this aggregates it all together. So these things that used to be, I wish I could do it on that network, this took care of it. And now the networks are starting to incorporate it in itself. It's a good time saver. And there's more than one. I haven't looked at it very recently, but another popular one is called Hootsuite. Has anyone used Hootsuite?
Heard of it.
I haven't used it very recently, so alternative to Buffer. There's a bunch of other ones, some that are like $1,000 a month.
But Buffer is a very popular one for most people. Hootsuite's another one. I haven't seen it recently. You can look it up on your own.
Has anyone else heard of any other sort of, you know, social media aggregating sites, management sites? There was one that I used to like a while ago. I haven't used it after they went to paid only. See if they're still around. Crowdbooster.com. Yeah, they're still around. I liked this one when it was free. What's their pricing now? See, starting at $119 a month. No, wait. No, $9 a month. It's not so bad. So here's another place. Same thing. Connect all of these accounts. The bronze one is one Facebook, one Twitter, one user, etc. More here, more there, and it's the same way about scheduling posts, seeing what's effective, what are the best times.
What did you post that really reached a lot of people?
So crowdbooster.com. So we looked at the general aspects of LinkedIn. A lot of it is familiar, a little bit is different. It's still up to you to post content. We've got some ideas, some management tools. We're going to end the main lecture in a little bit. Any final questions on LinkedIn? If you had created this account as a test account like myself, you would need to go over to your icon, Privacy and Settings, Manage, and they hit it somewhere about deleting the account. Let's see, where did they hide it? So it looks like it's a little bit hidden in there. It may be somewhere in here in the nice, pretty new settings, but I had to go down at the very bottom, go to the, no, there it is, closing your account. Subscription, closing your account, yeah. It's under account.
At the very bottom, closing your account. You click there and it would go through the process and then it would delete this testing account if it's just a fake account.
Now there is a spot there. I have a duplicate account, so there's probably a process there to merge both of these if you want. So before deleting it, I would check the Help Center. Okay, so when we come back next week, what we're going to do is we're going to use LinkedIn. I'm sorry, we're going to use Instagram. I kept saying Facebook all day today, and now I'm going to say LinkedIn all day next week. We're going to use Instagram next week. Just one moment. Remember to bring a device, iPhone, Android, tablet, whatever. And it's always a bit of an adventure to teach this because I'm going to be using an Android device. Some of you may have an iPhone. The screens may be slightly different, but we're going to say, here's this button, here's that button. It may be slightly different, but we should be on track. I'm going to be projecting my device on the screen here. Hopefully that turns out okay. And we're going to look at LinkedIn. We're going to create an account if you don't have one. Then we're going to look at setting it up and posting to it and the nuances and all the cool new stuff about LinkedIn. I mean about Instagram. Instagram, and that'll be next week. So let's have a little lab time. I'll turn the printer back on if you'd like to print. I'm going to put a copy of the notes that I wrote here. All of these notes that I wrote, I'm going to put them into the network folder. You can take those with you.